remote and sometimes lose touch with the world. We don't get any television stations. And even though we do get the daily newspaper, I mostly only get it to do all of the word puzzles. And of course, on Saturday, the Arithmocode is in the Halifax Chronicle Herald. So I do that, and I lose touch. And then I come back and I see what a mess the world is in, and it's very, very frightening. Just a couple of things going on, and we think that in February of 2011, civil society in Libya rose up against Muammar Gaddafi and his human rights violations. Gaddafi has ruled in Libya since 1969, when in a military coup he overthrew King Idris I, and since that time has created a nation filled with human rights violations, rivaling that of Saddam Hussein's Iraq or Kim Jong-il's North Korea. Come back and read more about the global financial debt crisis. For a little bit there, it appeared as if we had gone into a recession sometime in 2008, but then we were coming out of it. But now it looks like that's not the case when we consider the debt of nations that we have always considered blue chip nations that were solid, and we shake with fear. Recession is not over. What's coming up is unknown to anyone, and it seems the future is least known to economists who cannot make head nor tail the present situation. We've read this week about the famine in the Horn of Africa, particularly in Somalia, where 12 million people are near starvation and death may be imminent for them. We look at Syria. Syria, incidentally, has been under emergency law, or what we would call martial law, since 1962. If you can imagine living all those decades under martial law throughout the entire reign of Hafez al-Assad and now his son Bashar al-Assad. And in that place, as in Libya, civil society says, enough! Our human rights have been trampled, our dignity has been crushed. We demand equality and justice and fairness, and we are willing to die for it. Those are just a few of the things that are happening in the world today, and in every case, what is at the heart of all of those events are questions of human rights, human dignity, justice. What is underlying much of the conflict is racial inequality, gender inequality, class inequality. So what is in the future? Is it at all possible to imagine that somehow there will be good and positive resolutions to those struggles? The answer, of course, is yes. In spite of the fact that the world appears to be in a mess, there will be resolution because of what God has put inside of humankind to tackle such challenges and overcome them. What's more, I assure you of this. In a world where many people think the church is dying, because the church has been dwindling for almost as long as Syria has struggled under martial law, the church is not dying. The church is not threatened. What the church has, by the grace of God, and through the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, is still the solution and the answer and the resolution to every challenge, to every obstacle that seems insurmountable, to every pain and every sadness. The church has the way. A And in the years to come, as the church sets aside all the things that it never should have been and becomes what it should be, that is to say, the defender of human rights, the defender of human dignity, the defender of the worth of all humankind, the church will prosper and grow. And all of civil society and all thinking people will look to the church and say, this is the place. This is the source. This is the hope for the future. Future of Libya. Future of Syria. Future of every place where civil society rises up against oppression. This is the source of hope for the global debt crisis. This is the source of hope for famine throughout the Horn of Africa. We just read two simple little stories today. Stories that we teach our children in Sunday school, which appear to be not very complex, plain stories. When the brothers of Joseph go into Egypt in the midst of a famine that is destroying all of the land of Canaan, when they reach Egypt begging for a sack of grain, they are not met with a sack of grain. They are met with a one-on-one encounter with the man who rules all of Egypt. Joseph greets them. He weeps for joy. He gives them all that they want. And then he brings them to Egypt and gives them the land of Goshen. Heals their hurt. What in that little New Testament story today, where Jesus, having offended everyone in Israel and Judea, has no choice but to retreat into the region of Tyre and Sidon. Today, those are two beautiful cities on the coast of the Mediterranean in Lebanon, but at the time they were in Syria. Syria was a much larger region than it is today. He retreats because he has rejected the teaching of the ancestors. He has allowed his disciples to eat without washing. When the Pharisees came and criticized him, he said to them, "It is not what goes into you that makes you unclean, it is what comes from within you and goes out that makes you unclean." And of course, the Pharisees were greatly offended by that. And in fact, the disciples come to him and said, "Don't you realize how you have hurt and offended the Pharisees?" And Jesus left and went to Syria. But in Syria, he did not find peace. Instead, he found there were people there that had heard that he was a healer and one who gave justice. And so he is met by the Syrophoenician woman, or the Canaanite woman, and she cries out, "Son of David, help me. My daughter is sick. Heal her." And Jesus simply turns his face away. Will not answer. What a strange thing for Jesus to do, because we have seen that Jesus is compassionate towards everyone, and if someone is hurt or broken, Jesus responds to them and helps and heals them, but he turns away. Then the disciples say, "Lord, send her away. She is following behind us. She is screaming." And then Jesus turns to the woman and says, "I will not help you. I have only been sent to the lost sheep of Israel." We have never, ever heard Jesus say that to anyone. Turn down a plea for help from someone who is broken and sad. "Go away," he says. "I have only come for Israelites." cries out again, "Help me, my child is dying." And then Jesus says words that must shock and confuse us, because this does not sound like Jesus. He says to her, "It isn't right to give the children's food to the dogs." Now just to struggle with this, first of all, nobody knows why this passage is there. Nobody knows why Jesus speaks so harshly to this woman. No one knows why here Jesus speaks terms that are disrespectful and rude. It is so inconsistent with the rest of Scripture, where Jesus always speaks with tenderness and respect for the humanity of the other person. But it seems very likely that what's happening here is that Jesus is speaking in the way that the woman would expect him to speak because he is an Israelite. There are dozens of places in the Old Testament where it is made clear that the Israelites have absolute disdain for the Canaanites or the Syrians. Even though throughout all of the Old Testament there are many passages whereby God's people are called towards tenderness and grace for all foreigners and all sojourners, it is clear and specific that people of Canaan are to be despised above all others. So I don't think that these are words that Jesus means in the way that they come across. I think he is saying to her, "Why do you ask me? Because you know that my people have been called to disdain you." And he wants to get from that woman why she thinks that he is going to help her. And of course, in the end, what happens is he does help her. And so he demonstrates, in fact, that all of those times that the Old Testament calls the Israelites to disdain the Canaanites, that he overrules that and says that human need trumps everything else. So don't worry about the words too much. In the end, he does help, he does heal, compassion flows from him. But for the moment, he says, it is not right to give the children's food to the dogs. And then the woman says the words that makes all pet owners smile. And makes all human beings smile, because she is so quick and she is so clever. Jesus is pretty quick when it comes to sparring with the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Nobody gives answers as quickly and as cleverly as Jesus, except perhaps the Canaanite woman. And she says, "Oh, yes. But even the dogs are given the scraps that fall from the table." She says, "All I want are some scraps." And Jesus must have smiled very broadly and said, "All right." He said, "You got me. Your daughter is healed." It's pretty good. It is done. Even the dogs eat the scraps that fall from the table. Good, he says. You have it. In the next verses, 29 to 31, it goes on to say that while Jesus was in Syria, he healed many people. And of course, that's the big shock. Because now, even though he said a moment ago, "I have only come for Israel," it becomes obvious he has come for Israel and for Israel's most dreaded and hated enemies. And everybody in between. He heals the Syrians. He brings peace to the Canaanites. He loves those Tyrians. The Israelites should have hated. Then in verses 32 to 39, we have that story that I think is so important. The story of the feeding of the 4,000, not the 5,000. Now, Mark also has the feeding of the 4,000. And remember, I said to you before, it's not just a repetition of the feeding of the 5,000. It's a different story, because the 5,000 were fed in Judea amongst God's people. The 4,000 are always fed somewhere that is Gentile or heathen territory. In Mark, it happens in the Decapolis, the land of the Jebusites, the Girgazites, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Hivites, the Ammonites, and the Perizzites. In Matthew, the feeding of the 4,000 happens in Syria, another heathen land, but in the end, it's the same thing. They gather up the scraps that fall from the table. There are 7 baskets of leftovers. And in the ancient world, there were 7 heathen tribes representing the enemies of God. But in the end of the feeding of the 4,000, they pick up the scraps that fall from the tables. 7 baskets, 7 heathen nations. The love of God is for all these people. What these little stories do, the story of the Canaanite or the Syrophoenician woman, the story of the healings in Syria, the story of the feeding of the 4,000, what these stories do is show us this, that Jesus rejects racial inequality. He rejects religious inequality. He rejects gender inequality. He rejects class inequality. He rejects the principle of the separation of God's people from the rest of the world. He upholds compassion, grace, love, and the dignity of all humankind. Jesus, in this story and elsewhere, is the embodiment of human dignity, human worth, equality, and justice. And in his life, death, and resurrection, he says, these things are God's substance. Justice, equality, grace, and love. Around the world, that is what civil society is crying out for. Though they are challenged by dictatorial and totalitarian leaders, the cry for justice will have the victory, because it is of God. And I pray that you will know that you are a part of the church. And as a part of the church, it is your task to speak for such justice and grace and equality. And if you do, you will play your part in changing the world, filling the world with justice, bringing an end to poverty, an end to war and conflict. You will do that. God is in you. God is that cry for goodness and mercy and peace. It is the key for Libya, Syria, key for Africa, Latin America, for every us. Let's make sure the world knows that we are the place where such things are born and upheld and where they prosper. We will change the world. We as a church will go from strength to strength. You as individuals will feel the healing power of God in every part of your soul. In the name of the Father and of the Son,